Now that we've captured the design and transferred it to the PCB, let's do the setup, examine rules, shape the PCB, perform component placement, and the routing. It cannot be stressed enough that nothing should be done in the PCB until the layer stackup and the rules are in place. We begin by looking at the PCB view and exploring the properties. Note, we are starting from right after the initial transfer to the PCB from the schematics. Looking at the properties, we can see the familiar selection filter. This works much like in the schematics. Scrolling down, we get to the unit section. Here, we again have a choice of millimeter or mils. You may pick your preference here, but most fab houses are moving to millimeters. It's possible to toggle between them during the routing, as the settings will be updated based on the current state of these selected units. Expand the grid manager to see the default grid setting. To change the grid used for placement or routing, double-click on the entry to open up the grid editor window. You can set the X and Y step grids. You can either have the Y track the X, as you can see, or if you break the chain, you can now specify different grids for X and Y. Normally, I keep them the same. There are other settings here, but the grid is the most critical one. You can add additional Cartesian or polar grids using the Add button. This could be helpful during some layout and placements. This view is the 2D view of the PCB board. To switch to 3D, hit the 3 key. Use the mouse wheel to zoom in and out, or right-click in the view to drag. In 3D mode, you can also rotate the view by holding down the Shift key. This generates a trackball that you can now right-click on and rotate the view. Please experiment with this and try to get a feel for it. To switch back to 2D, click on the number 2 key. Now let's define the layer stackup for the board. Using the Design pull-down menu, let's pick Layer Stack Manager. The default PCB is a two-layer board, as you see here. It is recommended to keep the stack symmetry checked in order to create a balanced layer stackup for manufacturing. To add either a signal or power plane layer, click on the adjacent layer in the stack and the Add. Here we'll add below the current layer a signal layer. Notice that not one but two layers were added, again a result of the stack symmetry being set. Now we have a four-layer PCB stackup. Most of the table entries can be edited to match the target for the stackup, but we'll keep all the defaults as they are. Let's save the PCB and commit this new layer stackup to the PCB. To modify the board shape, we hit number 1. Now the view changes to a green board. In board planning mode, we can modify the board using the drop-down menu. The Edit Board Shape allows us to directly move the perimeter lines, defining the board as you can see. The manual moving is not very accurate. We will edit the global grid to allow us to edit more exactly. Hold down the Shift and the Control keys and then type G to access this setting. Here we'll set the grid to 1000 mils, so we can shape the board quickly with certainty. Note that even though the PCB units are in millimeter originally, we can still specify mils. Now, when you adjust the board, the grid will only allow 1-inch steps. Switching back to board mode by hitting the number 2, don't forget to change the grid steps back so we can do better placement. Now the board is shaped and we have a layer stackup, we need to next address rules. Click on Design and then Rules to open up the PCB Rules and Constraints Editor window. Here's a clearance rule. Note the first and second object matching shows all. This is the default rule and would apply to all the objects in the PCB. This clearance rule is an example of a binary rule in that it applies to two objects. Taking a quick look at the next few default rules for short circuits and unrouted nets, we would certainly not want for these to be in a design going to fab. Moving on to the routing rules, the default width. This rule is a unary rule in that it applies to an individual object. The default width is 10 mils for all the nets. Let's change the preferred and max widths by clicking on their entries and typing in the new values. These will apply to all nets on all layers. Click on the Apply to update this rule. Next, let's add an additional rule width to illustrate how to do so, as well as the important concept of priority. Duplicating the rule, we can target a particular net and can select the net from the drop-down list. Let's pick the 12 volts. Let's edit the rule now to allow for wider traces. We can and should edit the rule name to reflect its purpose. We must check the priority of these two width rules. Clicking on the Priorities button, we see the pop-up listing the two rules and their relative priorities. The first priority is the highest priority, but this is the default rule that will apply to all the nets. If we don't change this priority order, the power rule will never be applied. To change the priority, you just click on the Decrease Priority button. Now the special power rule is applied first, followed by the default rule. The priority matters, otherwise you would never be able to have a wider width. Let's hit Close and apply to set these rules in place, clicking OK to close the window. Now the board is shaped, rules are set, and the layer stack is set. We can now proceed with placement and then routing. Let's continue working on the PCB. We will use the rooms to move their components as a group to roughly place them on the PCB. The white lines that you can see are the connection fly lines. These are useful for placement and orientation of the components as they provide insight on what is connected and where. You can rotate the rooms when moving them by clicking on the spacebar. Do not ever use the X or Y transpose keys when you are in the PCB, as they may likely break the design as most footprints are not meant to be transposed either in the X or Y directions. Next, we delete the rooms as they have served their purpose. I do a rough placement, paying attention to the fly lines before adding any traces. To illustrate how to move a component from the top to the bottom, you pick it up and while moving it, hit the L key to toggle from the top to the bottom, and also back. You can see the effect on the pad colors, changing from red indicating the top to blue indicating the bottom layer. One viewing mode that is helpful is single layer viewing. Hitting the S key toggles between all the layers, which is normally how we look at the PCB, to single layer, grayed out others, and then to single layer only, as you can see. This is useful for routing and can help sometimes with placement as well. Again, it sort of clears up what you are looking at and makes it easier to see. The current active layer is highlighted at the bottom of the tabs. To switch tabs, either click on them or use the plus minus keys to cycle through them. The plus key cycles to the right, the minus key cycles to the left. Using the interactive route connections icon from the top menu, we can start routing. Notice we could have used Control and W as well. This will start routing on the current active layer. Click on the start of the route and then the endpoint to place the track. While routing, you can also place individual segments by clicking and continuing routing, adding either new segments or finishing on a pad. Let's show the remove loop feature in Altium Designer by rerouting this trace. Note that after you complete the trace, the duplicate traces are deleted. You can also adjust a route by selecting a segment of it and moving it. Zooming in on Q2, we will move the designator by clicking on it and dragging it. Now we can start to route Q2 pin 1 on the top layer and clicking an endpoint. We now hit the plus key. This will automatically drop in a via and start routing on the next signal layer. If we hit the plus key 2 more times, we will now have the bottom layer active and we can finish the connections to R2 on the bottom layer. Just for show, we will route on some of the inner layers starting on the bottom and hitting the minus key to go up to the next layer, and finish it with another via to get to the top layer and ending up on the top layer pad. Here's a quick look at each of the signal layers showing the vias and traces. Here we have everything routed at this point. Selecting the plus 12 net, hit the tab key to select all the connections on that top layer. We can use the properties panel to change the width for all of the selected traces. Selecting a ground trace segment and hitting tab multiple times will select all of the connected traces for this on all layers for the entire net. We can do things like delete the net if so desired. One thing I recommend is moving the designators for the connectors so that they are more readable. Switching to 3D will also help guide the tuning of the look and locations for all of the silkscreen information. At this point, we are now ready for design rule checking before creating fabrication files.